Hey everybody, today we want to talk about sugar. Very, very important topic for lots of reasons. First and foremost, the sugar in our diets, it's everywhere. We are constantly eating foods that have added sugar to them, and a lot of these added sugars are behind a lot of the chronic disease that we're experiencing and the discomforts that we're experiencing, and it's everywhere in the supermarket. It's addictive. We all have had our bouts, or many of us have had our bouts with sugar cravings and addictions and whatnot. So we really need to get an understanding of this topic as best we can. Now, books and books have been written on sugar. We're going to give you, we don't need to read tons of books. It's always great to read books and get further education, but it's pretty simple. And we believe a lot of these certainly broad topics can be broken down to very simple terms with very simple tips, as long as we have some really good solid information and some facts. So let's jump right into it. First off, sugar is everywhere. And when we're talking about sugar in this segment, we're talking about processed sugar, added sugar, the refined sugars that we talk about in processed foods. We're not talking about the sugar that we get from fruits, but we will address the difference in a little bit. Now, the problem with sugar is, like I said, it's everywhere. It's in 75% or more of the packaged food that's in the supermarket. It's added to things like juices, fruit juices, and milk. It's added to dressings and condiments. It's literally everywhere. Now, one helpful hint on reading labels, or one helpful tool for reading labels, when we go and we look at the sugar content in a product, we'll find that it's measured in grams. And to envision the amount of sugar in a serving, it's important to be able to envision how much that is. So you'll find this helpful that every 4 grams of sugar is 1 teaspoon. So if something has 12 grams of sugar, and be careful to look out for number of servings. They're gonna show you on the label the amount of sugar per serving. Some of these products that we're eating have multiple servings. Actually, most of them do. So per serving, the sugar measured in grams, every 4 grams is 1 teaspoon. That should help you to envision. I know it helped me quite a bit to envision exactly how much sugar I was dealing with in a serving of food. So keep that in mind. For every 4 grams, it's 1 teaspoon of sugar. So how much is too much sugar? We know we don't want a lot of sugar. We know we always want to cut down on processed foods, and a lot of us know that we need to cut down on our sugar, but what's a good amount? What's a good kind of recommended amount not to exceed? Because sugar in and of itself is not a nutrient. We don't need these types of sugars. They're not a macronutrient. Carbohydrates, which is what our body preferably runs on, fats and protein are the macronutrients. Sugar is not one of them. Yes, our body can use sugar for energy, but the types of sugar we're talking about are empty calories, zero nutritional value, and when we take in too much of it, we're satisfied temporarily, but hunger hormones are triggered shortly thereafter, because although we've gotten a lot of these empty calories, we've gotten no nutrients. So the body needs nutrients, so it's triggering hunger cells, hunger hormones, to take in more food because we haven't gotten the essential vitamins, minerals, amino acids, and whatnot. That's the problem with these empty calories, and they're all coming from the sugar-laden processed foods. Now, so let's get back to how much is too much. Now, the World Health Organization recommends that we not exceed 10% or more of our daily calories from sugar. And again, we're not talking about fruits and vegetables and sugars that we get from those foods. We're talking about the processed foods that we all know well and love and find it hard to give up. Now, let's think about a 2,000 calorie diet, just to make the number simple. So 10% of that would be 200 calories, okay? Now, for every gram of sugar, so there's 4 calories per gram, okay? So 4 calories per gram of sugar. Now again, 200, so 10% of 2,000 is 200. 200 calories divided by 4 calories per gram is gonna give you 50 grams of sugar, okay? Now, that again, This is just an amount not to exceed. So if we're not to exceed 50 grams of sugar today, which I believe is a lot, that's 12 and a half teaspoons, right? So again, for every 4 grams is a teaspoon, 50 grams equals 12 and a half teaspoons of sugar. So take 12 and a half teaspoons of sugar over the course of the day. That's quite a bit. And that's from the World Health Organization. That's their level not to exceed. Again, this is not a recommended amount to take, like vitamin C and vitamin A and blah, blah, blah. It's an amount not to exceed, and that's a very important distinction. You don't need any of this type of sugar, zero. So the average American, now check this out. So 12 and a half teaspoons is the amount recommended not to exceed. The average American is eating 22 teaspoons of sugar a day, almost double that. That's 88 grams of sugar. And it's in, like I said, everything. Now, where is it obviously? It's obviously in a lot of the sugary soft drinks that are on the markets. And they are not just your can of soda. They're your apple juices. They're your vitamin waters. They're your Snapple iced teas. Let's take a look at some of these products just to give you an example of how much sugar is in just one 16-ounce can of Coca-Cola. It's amazing. It's 52 grams of sugar. So you've already exceeded the amount not to exceed with one 16-ounce can of soda. What about a Snapple iced tea? That's got 36 grams, and that's 36 grams, 9 teaspoons. Vitamin water, a 20-ounce vitamin water has 32 grams of sugar. Like, it's what we need from our water is water, added sugar. Again, 32 grams is 8 teaspoons. That's a lot. That's 3/4 of our amount not to exceed just right there. And what we think is hydrating, nourishing water. It's got a lot of added sugar. Even look at the apple juice that we give our kids, you know, and some of these other fruit juices, the orange juices. So Mott's apple juice per 16 ounces, and I'm using 16 ounces just so you can see in an equal measure of food, although the vitamin water is a standard 20-ounce bottle. In apple juice, 56 grams of sugar. So more than the 16-ounce bottle of Coca-Cola. 16 ounces of just Mott's apple juice has more sugar than soda, and this is what we're giving our kids. That, just imagine a little kid drinking a couple of things of apple juice a day in a sippy cup. That's an incredible amount of sugar. It's sugar and water. Again, no real nutrients, a small amount of some vitamins, most of which have been added back to these fruit juices because they're from concentrate, which means that they've been dried out, reduced to a powder, so that the shelf life can last longer, and then water is added back and a lot more sugar. So we need to watch out. The sugar, again, is in everything. It's in the cookies, it's in the chips, the ice cream, the white bread, the bagels, the pretzels, again, the salad dressings, the mustards, the ketchups. It is everywhere. It's in all these baked goods. And looking at the label and quantifying in teaspoons how much is in there and trying to keep that to as much of a minimum as possible is really going to help, because all of this sugar, especially this refined sugar, it's taxing on our livers. Excessive amounts of sugar damages our gut bacteria, which is vital for the digestion and assimilation of food, but it's also vital to our immune system and a multitude of other functions and hormone production and vitamin production. Gut health is incredible and is incredibly important, and excessive amounts of sugar, these refined sugars, is damaging our guts. It's causing incredible amount of difficulty and problems, and is at the root of a lot of the chronic diseases, especially the digestive diseases. So cutting these down as quickly and as much as possible is going to allow our bodies to heal and rebuild in dramatic fashion. Be amazed. So when we get health forms from clients, I would say a majority of them, we have a category asking what cravings people experience, and a majority have sugar cravings that they experience, and we get that. Now, why is that? Is sugar addictive? Is this type of sugar addictive? And more studies have been done to show that yes, in fact, it is addictive. It's basically a shot of liquid drug. Now, studies done with rats who had a choice of sugar water or coke or water with cocaine in it, almost every time went for the sugar water. Now, there's a physiological reason behind this. These refined sugars stimulate continued dopamine release in our brain. Now, dopamine is the "that feels good, let's do it again" response that we get, which is why drugs like heroin are referred to as dope. Dopamine is released. That is the underlying release in most drug and alcohol addiction. It's the dopamine that is adding to our cravings. And that is experienced in these high glycemic index foods, which I'm going to get to now. We're going to talk about the glycemic index. So your brain, that reward center, that feel good, that I want more of, that center in the brain is constantly triggered by sugar. So like any addiction, we need to get rid of it if we're going to overcome it. And we need to abstain or dramatically reduce the amount of these types of sugars in our diet. And again, I'm not talking about fruit. I will spend a couple minutes differentiating between the sugar in fruit, which is fructose, versus these sugars that I'm talking about. And I also, and then we'll talk about diabetes, and then we'll end it there. Let's talk about the glycemic index. Now, what is it? The glycemic index is a measure of the amount of sugar in our blood over a course of a few hours after we have ingested it. Now, foods that are high on the glycemic index, and it's all benchmarked to 100. 100 is pure glucose. So if we took pure glucose, it would be 100. Now, foods that are high in the glycemic index are spiking our blood sugar levels to a very high level and resulting in more insulin to be produced to take this high amount of sugar in our blood and get it into the cells. So the more sugar in the blood, the more insulin that has to be produced. Now, high glycemic index foods are actually not fruit. Most fruit is on the moderate level, the 55, 65 and lower. The high glycemic index foods, 75%, 85% higher, are in these refined processed foods. For example, French fries on the glycemic index, again, out of 100, 75. Pizza, 80. Pretzels, 83. Gatorade, 78. Donuts and cake, 76. Jelly beans, what do I have for jelly beans? Jelly beans are 85. Mashed potatoes, 83. Cheerios that we give our kids, 75. Corn flakes, 80. Waffles, white bread, all very, very high, 80 and above, 75, 80 and above. Very problematic for blood sugar levels, requiring more insulin to be produced. Now, low on the glycemic index, which is going to be, 40 or lower, kind of 50 or lower. Bananas, mangoes, oranges, pineapples, plums, blueberries, strawberries. Grapefruits are only 25 on the glycemic index. Moderate, cherries, kiwi, dates, raisins, cantaloupe, all moderate. The only one that's really high on the glycemic index is watermelon. It's around 80. So again, most fruits are low to moderate on the glycemic index. Now, when people are suffering from prediabetes or diabetes, which I want to talk about now, they have been encouraged to cut down on fruit. And that does make a lot of sense. If you have an A1C level, now A1C is a measurement of the average blood sugar level in your body over the course of the past few months. So it eliminates the spikes in our blood sugar and kind of takes a look at how much, on average, sugar is in our blood over the past few months. And this is a very important indicator. So I strongly recommend having your A1C level tested in addition to your normal blood work that you're hopefully getting periodically. Now, the A1C level, if it's, 6.5 or higher, you're in the diabetes range. If it's 5.7 to 6.5, you're in the pre-diabetic range. The CDC, the Center for Disease Control, has estimated that over 100 million Americans are suffering from diabetes or pre-diabetes. That's about 40% of the population, of the adult population. What's more alarming than that, this is epidemic. This qualifies, in my opinion, as epidemic proportions. What's even more eye-opening and alarming and actually scary is the level of pre-diabetes and diabetes in teens, children, and young children. It's becoming ever more prevalent. It's the fastest growing chronic disease issue in our children, is diabetes and pre-diabetes along with obesity. So this is incredibly important. This is an incredibly important topic. That's why we need to really focus on these processed sugars and get and eliminate them as much as possible. Let's talk about diabetes and for a minute, and the role of fruit and the role of these processed sugars in diabetes. This is incredibly important. The amount, again, let's talk about how diabetes, like what causes diabetes. Now, most of us are going to say, well, diabetes is caused by too much sugar in our blood, and that is not the case. Sugar in the blood is problematic and is a contributing factor to diabetes and prediabetes, but it is not in and of itself the cause of type 2 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is caused by insulin resistance. What does that mean? Now, when I eat sugar, sugar gets into my blood, usually pretty quickly. The body, the pancreas, will secrete insulin. Now, insulin's job is to escort. It's an escort. It goes into the blood, it gets released into the blood, gets the sugar molecules and says, okay, sugar molecules, come with me. I'm going to take you to the cells of the body. The reason why is I can put that sugar into the, it'll put the sugar into the cells of the body so that can be used for energy, for movement. It gets stored in our muscles. And so insulin escorts the sugar over to the cells, knocks on the cell door. The cell recognizes insulin and says, oh, okay, you've got some sugar for us. We'll open the hatch, send the sugar in, boom, insulin goes away. Its job is done. Now, listen to this, because you may not have heard this. The problem with diabetes and what causes insulin resistance is not too much sugar in the blood. It's too much fat in the cells. Now, when the insulin brings the sugar to the cell and the cell doesn't open to take in any more sugar, it's because the communication within the cell has been disrupted because there's too much fat in the cell. So the signaling within the cell to open the hatch so that insulin can have the sugar put into the cell no longer works. It's not functioning properly. So that hatch doesn't open up and insulin can't do its job. So what happens? That insulin, that sugar stays in the blood. And what happens? The body then releases even more insulin. And this is the problem. So if we've got a lot of fat in our diet, and that includes your extra virgin olive oil, as Dr. Neil Barnard from PCRM likes to say, it's all the fat in our diet that is messing with this communication in our cells and not allowing for insulin to do its job of escorting the sugar in our diet into the cells for use. Now, that is what causes insulin resistance, which then causes diabetes, type 2 diabetes. That is the problem. Now, how do we alleviate this? Well, first and foremost, if we're pre-diabetic or diabetic and we're insulin resistant, yes, we want to cut down on the amount of sugar. We don't want to contribute to more sugar in our blood, even though that's not the cause of our type 2 diabetes. We do want to cut it down, even from fruit. We want to get our sugar levels, you know, down by getting rid of this fat in our cells. How do we do that? We go to a more plant-based diet. We get rid of the fats, the oils and whatnot, and the loaded processed sugars. A lot of the processed high glycemic index foods that I just mentioned also come with a lot of fat, right? The French fries are cooked with oil. The donuts are fried formed in some kind of vat of fat. This is the problem. So it's not just one thing. It's not just all the sugar in a diet. It's the fat, and that's coming from the meats, the processed meats, the dairy, the eggs. getting rid of that and going more plant-based will help bring these A1C levels down and bring them down dramatically. So going more whole foods and eventually bringing in some more fruits, more high level of fruit over time as that A1C level comes down, fantastic, go nuts. But in the early stages of getting that level down, lots of fruit, lots of vegetables, you know, lots of low fat, good rices and pastas made from really good grains or lentils or peas or chickpeas. Sauteing our vegetables, that is how, and getting rid of the sugary drinks and adding more water, just pure water to help flush these fats and toxins out of our system. That is how we're going to help our A1C levels and get these blood sugar levels down. Very, very important. I hope that was explained in a way that you can understand easily, because it had to be explained to me that way. And I was amazed when I found out that diabetes is not caused by simply just eating too many sugary foods. It's that fat in our cells. So the challenge for us is, again, focusing on the labels. Of all the things on the labels that we need to look at, we really want to look at sugar content. We want to look at the number of servings, and we want to envision how many teaspoons that's in there. Is there added sugar to my food, and how much? Why? I don't need it. It's not a nutrient. I can get all the carbs that I need for my body to run on from healthy, whole foods, period. We don't need any of these things. We're hooked on them, though. I get it. I struggle with it myself to this very day at times. You know, emotionally, I want to reach for. Luckily for me, I don't reach for alcohol anymore, and I don't reach for nicotine anymore or any other drug. But I do reach for that sugar, man. I get it. And like any other addiction, abstinence is the best recipe. If we are going to have some, you know, we got to really try to keep it to a moderate level. So empty calories, not a nutrient. Fruits, when your A1C level is at 5.5 or lower, enjoy it all you want on an empty stomach. But let's get our guts healed. Again, the beauty of a plant-based diet and eating whole foods is you don't have to worry about this stuff. Your body regulates itself. The A1C comes down. The weight comes off. The cholesterol levels go down. The blood pressure goes down. This just happens by switching to more and more whole foods in the diet. But believe me, I've seen it happen in my own body, and I've seen it happen in tons and tons of other people's bodies when they do this. This is just getting out of the way, giving your food the nutrients and the healthy food designed by nature for the human body, loving ourselves and devoting ourselves enough to ourselves to treat ourselves well by giving us these healthy whole foods. And then we don't have to worry about all the crap. We don't have to put money in the pockets of these corporations with their false advertising, and we don't have to watch our kids start to experience chronic disease at a younger age. It's in the crap shit food in the supermarket, and it's everywhere. So please, you know, consider making your own level of challenge, how much you want to cut out. What are some things we can do? In our coffee, we can use raw honey. We can use stevia, which is plant-based. You know, if our A1C levels are in check, we can substitute some healthy fruits instead of the sugary snacks. Fruits designed by nature to advertise themselves with these beautiful, robust, bright colors. It's basically saying, eat me. A human eye, as opposed to a carnivore, is built to see colors vividly. Why? When we were hunter-gatherers in a forest and we saw an apple or a pear or a banana or grapes or blueberries, our eyes were triggered. It stood out. It advertised, and then we ate it, and it was sweet and good, so we wanted more, and it nourished us. That's nature's way of advertising fruit. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. Ditching the soft drinks. Let's try to cut out those soft drinks, those sodas, those iced teas, even these vitamin waters, this crazy stuff. Look at the labels. Have some just pure water. We're 70% water. Just have water. We need it. We lose it. We need to replenish it. The purer, the better. And we're getting a lot of water, hopefully, from the whole foods we're eating. try a cold pressed juice, fruit, vegetable juice, or make a smoothie. Sweet, delicious, healthy, water-based, or nut milk based. This is gonna build us up. This is going to crowd out the processed garbage that's tearing our bodies down, and conversely, build us up and make us stronger, make us cleaner, make us lighter, make us sharper, give us more vitality. What a beautiful thing. And we all have the power to do that within us. Our bodies do it without us even knowing. All we have to do is feed it and nourish it properly. The body will do the rest. And the results are amazing. Amazing. So I hope that was helpful. I know sugar is a huge topic, but it doesn't have to be. We don't have to read volumes and volumes of books on it. It's all pretty damn simple. And hopefully I made it simple for you today. But any questions or whatnot, you know, please pop them in the chat, and we can elaborate further. All right. Have a great day, everybody.